Hey, free trading cards.
Wow! Joseph of Arimathea! 26 conversions in AD 46.
Whoa, a Methuselah rookie card!
Well, boys, who'd have thought learning about religion could be fun?
Did Eve ever have a date with Adam? No, just an apple.
My parents, they also became Christian when I was born. And everybody's still Christian, but I got them when they were the most Christian. I had 80s and 90s Christian parents. Well, that's the most Christian you can ever get of the Christian. I think Jesus had more fun than I did. I was not allowed to watch anything. I mean, when they made The Simpsons, it was like, I guess they're just showing R-rated TV shows now.
Did you know that it wasn't the apple that caused all the trouble in the Garden of Eden?
No.
No, it wasn't the apple. It was the pear on the ground.
Oh, God. I don't know. Jesus had a little brother. Anybody know his name? James. When I read that, I was like, how much pressure was that? Jesus, your big brother? How many times did you have to hear, why come you can't be more like Jesus, James? Because you know, everybody probably thought that James could do the same thing Jesus could do, but he couldn't. He was just James. He wasn't James Christ. Remember the wedding banquet? Jesus turned water into wine. Everybody was amazed, but they don't tell you about the next banquet. Jesus left early. They started running out of wine. Everybody looked at James. It's like, man, last time this happened, your brother made some wine, dude. You just going to stand there with your sandals on? You're not going to... Can you make some Kool-Aid or something? Man, you're not going to do anything.
They pray before NASCAR races. You know that they pray... What? What's the prayer? Jesus. We have engineered these cars to go 250 miles per hour. We will race them for 6 hours, 3 inches from each other. We just pray that you would help us not to die. God's like, yeah, just don't race, dude. Amen. Start your engines. Ah!
Well, good morning, everyone. Who here is alive, awake, alert, enthusiastic? If that's you, go ahead and put it in the chat. If you are on our website or on YouTube, let me know if you're feeling alive, awake, alert, enthusiastic. Also, it's cold here in Northwest Ohio, and I also have a cold. So I am drinking tea this morning. When I'm feeling a little cheeky, I'll drink tea over coffee. And I'd also love to know, do you prefer tea or coffee? Put it in the chat. Also, let me know who you are, where you're watching from. I would love to know. And also, everyone who is joining our chat right now, I want to say hello to you, because right now I'm away from the computer, so I can't type it in the chat. But I am thankful that you are here. And if you have never met me, we've never met in person or online or otherwise, my name is Brian Dario. I am the online pastor, and I'm thankful that you are joining us. That video was hilarious, and I can definitely relate. As a kid who grew up in the 90s in that Christian world, it was interesting. For my wife, she also was not allowed to watch The Simpsons growing up. Who can relate? Let me know again in the chat. Well, you are joining us in the middle of our series, Losing My Religion, where today we will discover what is the religious way to find a relationship with God, and then what is the way that Jesus shares with us that to find that relationship with God? You want to stay tuned for that. But before we get there, if you joined us last week, you know that if you're on the website, we put up a poll asking you, if you were to join an online group, when would be your preferred time? Well, today, I've got another poll for you. I'm going to put it up in the chat as soon as I'm done here. I want to know, if you are going to join an online group, what kind of group would you like to join? What interests you? This will help me and my team find ways that we can connect with you. So please take part in that poll. And while you're doing that, feel free to stand up if you'd like. You don't have to, as we worship together.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see you. Those of you at Oregon and online, welcome in. I want to invite you all to sing with us.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. Thank you, God. When all I see is a cross, God, you see the empty tomb. So nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Shine in the shadows, you win every battle.
To build our lives upon than that of Jesus Christ. So today, let's proclaim that we're gonna do just that. Let's build everything on the name of Jesus Christ.
I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. Well, God, we gather this morning, and I'm thankful that you meet us right where we're at. Whatever it is that we're thinking about, whatever it is that we're navigating in our lives, God, you see us fully, and you welcome us as we are. And so, God, as we continue to sing today, pray that these words can just penetrate every part of our being. God, as we sing about building our lives upon you, God, give us the faith to do just that. God, help us to remember the hope that we get to experience not only for all of eternity, but for today because of what Jesus accomplished through his death and his resurrection. And so the power, the peace, the purpose that you invite us into because of what Jesus has done, we proclaim those things today, here and now, in the name of Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is love. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety, to every soul mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Your name.
I love getting to worship together. Even though we're not in the same room, we are still worshiping in spirit. If you were standing, you can now take a seat, or you can lay down if you're pretty tired. Feel free to do whatever you want. Also, thank you for participating in the poll and in the chat, letting me know the things that you're passionate about. I do appreciate that. Also, that song, Speak Jesus, I love it. I love the message of that song and the truth that with that kind of truth of speaking Jesus, we're able to witness a transformation in other people's lives when we get to be a witness to what Jesus has done in our lives. And that's our heartbeat as a dream team at Cedar Creek Church. I'm not talking about the early 90s basketball team dream team. I'm talking about the name for our volunteers at church. It is their heart to speak Jesus to everyone for every dream team role, from the greeter at the door who's high-fiving you and giving you a fist bump as you walk in, to those who are back in the kids' spaces teaching these kids about Jesus. Every role matters. And I would love to introduce you to one Dream Team member who I get to call friend. Her name is Amy Boggs. Some of you might recognize her name. She is one of my chat moderators who typically serves at almost all of the services, although I know she is now in person at the Perrysburg campus watching service. Amy, she started coming to Cedar Creek 2 years ago and was referred by a friend to join Growth Track. And so she joined the first iteration of online Growth Track with me, which is how I met Amy. And through the course of Growth Track, which is designed to help you discover your purpose, Amy found out that some of her spiritual gifts are encouragement, mercy, hospitality. And so she was able to take those gifts, and she decided to join the online dream team. And many of you have experienced her gifts of encouragement and mercy and hospitality as she welcomes guests into the chat and she engages in worship. And I know, I'm about to preach right now, I know some of you get it. You understand that sometimes you just need somebody to listen as you share about how your week has been. And Amy has a great set of ears to listen to some of the things you've struggled with. So maybe right now, as you're hearing me talk about Amy, you're feeling that little bit of a nudge. You've completed Growth Track, and you're wondering, what's my next step? Maybe it's to join a dream team. And I'm looking at you right now, those of you who are watching online, we could use more online chat moderators. If you're interested, you can join me and my friends to chat moderate. If you're interested in doing that, just put it in the chat and we'll talk. But maybe you're also at a campus. You call a different campus home. Consider joining one of the dream teams at that campus. And then how about for you who've never joined Growth Track? Maybe this is your step to join. We offer Growth Track at all of our campuses as well as with me online. You can find all of the details at cedarcreek.tv/growthtech.
One of the things I love about teaching here is the research process that goes into building a message. I love reading commentaries about the Bible, books about our topic, talking with other people, listening to other sermons. But this particular series has allowed me to do research in a different way. So for the past couple weeks, we've been talking about religion and how we want to convince you to lose your religion. And one of the analogies we've used is tickets, like you would earn at Chuck E. Cheese. And so I decided I would need to do some research for work, obviously, and I would need to go to Chuck E. Cheese. I have not been, though, in probably over 20 years, probably more than that. And I wasn't just going to go by myself, because a grown man walking around Chuck E. Cheese by himself, a little weird. Now, if you do that, and you're a dude here, no judgment. I'm just saying, for your sake and everybody else's, stop. Anyway, so I took my kids, my oldest two, Ruby and Easton, to Chuck E. Cheese. Now, we are a Dave and Buster's family. We're a big fan of Dave and Buster's. We love Dave and Buster's. We go about once or twice a year. And no matter how many times I've been there, my reaction is the same when I walk in. I walk in and I look around, I'm like, whoa, big lights, games everywhere, good food. It's nice, it's loud, it's exciting. I will play for hours. In fact, my wife, Kayla, it's her birthday today, no big deal. Yeah, thank you. She's not here. She's not here, but I just needed to do that. She's turning 29 again. Just keeps happening. It's wild. Anyway, so she'll be like, hey, guys, we're done. It's time to go home. We've been here for a while. My kids at that point are like, all right. And I'm like, no, please. Because I love Dave and Buster's. Can we just stay? So I was like, all right, love Dave and Buster's. Every time I walk in, whoa. Now, took the kids to Chuck E. Cheese, and I walked in. My reaction was, whoa. This is not how I remember it. This is different. Yes, the creepy rat is still there, at least the one I went to. But the games were a little bit difficult. Not like because they were challenging. It's because a lot of them were broken. This was kind of how I felt about going to Chuck E. Cheese. Kids were excited. No, I'm just kidding. We did have a lot of fun. Here's the next picture of us. That particular picture machine was one of the broken ones. Just kept, you didn't have to pay for it at all. Just kept giving you pictures. We took a lot of pictures. This next slide is my kids playing a game. This is Ruby, the back of her head, and East in the back of her head, so now you know what they look like. And that's a water gun that when they'd pull the trigger, it would shoot water at the screen that would freeze zombies that were trying to attack them. It was a cool game. But in the middle of them playing the game, the machine started yelling at them. And my kids started yelling, low on water, please refill. Low on water, please refill. And it just kept yelling and yelling and yelling, and I'm like, somebody gonna, you know, fix this? It's pretty loud. My kids are ignoring it completely. This employee wanders over. He's like, I don't think he walked like that, but that's what it felt like. And he just looks at the screen. Kids are shooting. It's just, low on water, please refill. Low on water, please refill. And I'm like standing over here, and I'm like, you bring your jug or what's like, you know, it's got to get fixed. And he looks at the screen intently, and he's like, looks at me. I look back at him. He looks at the screen. He's like, I don't know, and just walks away. And I was like, it seems pretty obvious to me. Now, this was not the only machine that was pleading for help from the employees. There were several that were like, please fix me, yelling about how they were broken. Chuck E. Cheese did not live up to the hype for me. We did earn tickets, though. We did. And we walked to the counter. And parents, you know this. If you've ever done this before, you've been to an arcade with your kids. When you get to the counter, it takes them longer to buy things or to figure out what they want than it did for them to earn the tickets. We had 600 tickets, which isn't that much. 600 tickets, if you don't know this, I do now, that earns you roughly 6 3-inch Tootsie Rolls, about that big. That's what you get. So my kids decided to get a couple of those and some vampire teeth that they probably lost already. It was kind of a bummer. I was like, I don't really like Chuck E. Cheese anymore. Easton, my son, was like, can we eat the pizza here? I'm like, definitely not, bro. That's buffet style. I don't know who's been touching that. We're going to get Chick-fil-A. All right, let's go. So we leave, and I sat there, I'm like, Dave and Buster's is so much better. And then I thought, how am I going to use this for my talk? Because as a kid, I would go to arcades. There was one at Franklin Park called Red Baron, Franklin Park Mall. If some of you are nodding your heads, you know the Red Baron was sweet. It was two floors, and I never really struggled to get tickets that I remember. I could get not whatever I wanted, but I got enough stuff, so it wasn't like a good analogy for me. So I thought, Andy, you need a different analogy. Where do you fall short, Andy? Some of you are giggling because you happen to know that I am short. And so I thought immediately about my height. And I was like, that's where I fall short. When did you first know, Andy, third person, kind of strange, that you were short? When did it really kind of hit you hard? And it was my first trip to Cedar Point, and I wanted to ride the big rides. Come on! So anyway, I get there. I'm all excited, thinking about going on the Gemini. It's going to be sweet. Get there in this employee with his stupid candy cane pole comes out, sticks it right in front of me, and he's like, you're not tall enough, bro. I'm like, he didn't say bro, but the little guy. And I was just bummed. I was so bummed. I was so upset because I had to walk by every ride and see all the people that were blessed with height to get on these rides. And then I'm sitting there, and I'm like, this is a bummer. My mom's, you know, she feels terrible. She's like, you can ride the junior Gemini. I'm like, I'm not riding that crap. I want to ride the big Gemini. I went to big rides. Now I got all these kids that are younger than me. They're like, look at that short guy. What's wrong with him? So then I was like, all right, this is a good analogy. I didn't measure up. So I thought I'd bring in my own prop. This is from my house. This is a height board or a measuring board, whatever. My kids don't know that they're going to be short when they grow up yet. They're not aware. So they like this exercise right now. They will find out when they're adults that this is a source of trauma, this board is. Now, what's awesome about this weekend is it's not installed on my wall. So if I stand next to it, you might think I'm close to being 6 foot tall, and I am going to let you continue to believe that for the rest of this message. So I know that for me, it was like I didn't measure up and it was kind of difficult. And some of you are like, oh man, 48 inches. I feel like I just came out the womb that tall. Like I was 40. And honestly, if that's you, if you're one of those tall people, there are exits at all of our auditoriums. You can just leave and go do what tall people do. Play basketball. I don't know. Try to fit into small cars and struggle with it. Shop at the big and tall store. Reach the top shelves. Go to Cedar Point. All that stuff. Have fun. Just kidding. You can stay. I will say this. I want to be like totally transparent. I can go to Cedar Point now, and I can ride most of the rides that are there. It's pretty nice. I can ride them all. Thank you. Thank you. I figured that was worth applause. I can ride them all, I think. Anyway. So today we're talking about religion. We've been talking about it for the past couple weeks. Our goal is to help you to lose your religion. And that kind of sounds interesting for some of you. So here's how we've defined religion. Religion is focusing on what we must do to earn God's favor. Focusing on what we must do to earn God's favor. And we've been comparing that to like earning tickets, to being good enough. And so for today, earning God's favor is measuring up, is being spiritually tall enough so that God will be pleased with you. And my invitation today, and I think Jesus' invitation is to tell you, is like there's a much better way to do life than to try and be good enough. There is a much better way, and I think we're going to see that today. We're going to be in the gospel according to Matthew. So if you have a Bible or you have your phone, you can pull up Matthew chapter 23. Right before we get into chapter 23, right before those events are recorded by Matthew, he actually talks us through some other things that happen. Jesus was going toe-to-toe with the religious elites, like the top of religion. They were the Pharisees. And Jesus was arguing with them publicly. He was challenging them publicly. They were challenging him, and he was responding to their questions with answers and other questions that left them dumbfounded and frustrated. He was even kind of sarcastic with them. He would say things like, have you even ever read your Bible that you're supposed to be an expert in? Like, he was going to town on these guys. He was. In fact, when you read the New Testament, the most harsh language Jesus uses, you'll see, is reserved for religious people. He is brutally honest. In fact, right before our chapter today, right before chapter 23, the last verse in chapter 22 says that he had frustrated them so much that they didn't dare ask him any more questions. So here's what Matthew says next. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, quick Bible study tip that works for me is when you're reading kind of like a story in the Bible, it's very helpful to stop and try to picture what's going on here. I try to picture what the person is writing. So just imagine you have Jesus, who has spent some time kind of calling out these religious leaders, and now he's got crowds of people that are listening to him. It would include the religious leaders. It would obviously include his disciples, his learners, his followers, and then everybody in between. And if you've read the Gospels, you know that everybody in between included all different types of people, including people that the religious leaders didn't want to be around, let alone allow to be religious. People like tax collectors and prostitutes and people that wouldn't fit in their religion. They weren't good enough. They didn't measure up. And this is the crowd of people that Jesus is talking to. And here's what he says. It says, the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees, now he's pointing them out again, are the official interpreters of the law of Moses. So practice and obey whatever they tell you, but don't follow their example, for they don't practice what they teach. This is one of the biggest criticisms that people have of church people. Is that we are a bunch of hypocrites. You guys know the word. We're going to talk about that today. Jesus continues and he says, they crush people with unbearable religious demands and never lift a finger to ease the burden. When you read the Bible from Genesis all the way to Revelation, the first book all the way to the end, you see that God's whole intent in his creation, the reason why he created everything was because he wanted to dwell with his creation. He wanted to be present with us. He wants to be around us, to do life with us. And when we resist him and when we say we don't want to trust him, we don't want to be around him, then bad things tend to happen. He wants to dwell with us. God wants to be around people. And so it frustrates him when people mistreat other people. It frustrates him that when people on his behalf mistreat other people and constantly point out how they don't measure up. And this is what the Pharisees did. There's a couple verses in between our next one where Jesus keeps calling them out and talks about how they're prideful and arrogant and all that stuff. And then what he's going to do is he's going to introduce these things called the seven woes. Depending on the translation you read, it'll say seven woes. Today it'll be the seven sorrows. He's going to talk about seven things that religious people do that bring sorrow or woe or trouble on themselves and everybody around them as well. Before he introduces those things, though, he's going to say something that kind of sets the table for us. He says this. He says, the greatest among you must be a servant, but those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. My Jesus-following friends today, I want you to know that over the next few minutes, it's going to feel like heavy. It's going to feel like a lot. It's going to feel like Jesus is angry. And here's the deal. We're used to reading about Jesus, and there is this part of him where he's gentle and kind, and he's just like, it seems so nice to be around him. But there's also the other side of Jesus where he does get angry. And he typically, his anger is reserved for religious people. It's reserved for religious people. And so what he's saying to us here is like, hey, if you're going to follow me, if you want that intimate relationship with me, it's going to require honesty. It's going to require humility. Humility takes honesty, and honesty is really the key to following Jesus. If we're going to lose our religion, set aside all the unbearable demands that religion places on us, the constant need to be good enough to measure up, if we're going to set all of that aside, and this is your bottom line, you can lose your religion by being honest about you. And this is very hard work. But Jesus is going to help us. He's going to help us by telling us about the seven sorrows. So here's how he starts. He says, what sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees? Hypocrites. There's that word again. Now, the word hypocrites, he was borrowing from like Greek stage play. Back then in Greek theater, the actors would wear masks, and the word hypocrite means actor or pretender. And so he's talking about these people, these religious authorities, religious people like me and like you, some of you, are pretenders. You're actors. You're faking it. In fact, one of the ways you could translate hypocrite would be the person underneath. Like there's something going on underneath the surface. You're presenting yourself as something different than what you actually are. And that's what the religious leaders were doing. He calls them hypocrites. He says, for you shut the door of the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. You won't go in yourselves, and you don't let others enter either. Entrance into the kingdom, following Jesus, requires honesty. And what religious people do, and this is part of being a hypocrite, and I do this, and I know you do this, and this is the first sorrow, is we decide who's in and who's out. We love to do this. Who's good enough to be a part of this community? Like, religious people, real quick, if you were to walk into church and see somebody greeting that made you like, I don't know, this is deciding who's in or who's out. If you were to see this type of person at your church, you would go, I don't know. That person isn't living the way that they should. Those people don't do what I think they should. They're not living a Christian life. They're not. This is deciding who's in or who's out. This is what hypocrites do. This is what I do. This is what many of you do. And Jesus is saying there's a better way. In fact, what's interesting about our text today is it's written by a guy named Matthew. And Matthew was, if you don't know, a former tax collector that Jesus had called out of that and into following him. Matthew knew more than any of the other disciples what it was like to be cast out by religious authorities. And nobody's saying that what he did do was okay. Like collecting taxes on behalf of the occupying force that was hurting and betraying and doing terrible things to your friends and neighbors and family members isn't a good thing. But he was cast out for this by the religious authorities, and they couldn't believe that Jesus would allow this person to follow him closely. Matthew was intimately aware of what it was like to feel cast out. And some of you today that are watching know what it feels like as well. It's tough for you to walk into church because you're afraid of what people might think or say. Because the church, as you know, as I know, is full of hypocrites. People that decide who's in or who's out. I can belong, but they can't. This is the first sorrow. Second sorrow. What sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees? Hypocrites, for you cross land and sea to make one convert, and then you turn that person into twice the child of hell you yourselves are. And I heard it. Ooh. Again, he reserves some of his most harsh words for religious people. What's he getting at here? The Pharisees, the religious leaders, reveal to us, and we know this, is that religion is hyper-competitive. It's hyper-competitive. The Pharisees back then would make even more strict laws than they had to see who could be the most religious. Do you know people like this? Are you like this? Constant, like, I measure up. I'm good enough. Look what I do. I serve every weekend. I give more than 10%. I don't swear. I parent the right way. I date the right way. Look at how good I am. This is what he's getting at here. And what happens is when you convert people to that, when you bring people into the fold of that religion, you make them twice, Jesus is saying, you make them twice as terrible as you are. And so you have a bunch of people carrying around measuring sticks, revealing to everybody else, look at how bad you are. Look how good I am. Look how bad you are. Why is this dangerous? Why is this dangerous? Because you will eventually be found out. You will. People are going to find out. They are. Jesus knew. What do hypocrites do? This is the second sorrow. What do hypocrites do? They make more hypocrites. You can't help it. If the whole goal of life is to be good enough, then you convince people to be a part of that being good enough, and they convince other people to be part of that being good enough, and everybody walks around thinking that you just have to be really moral and then God's okay with you. And that is not what Jesus taught. That is an unbearable burden for you to carry, for me to carry. So if we're going to lose our religion, we got to be honest. We got to be honest about ourselves, that we tend toward hypocrisy, and when we tend that way, we tend to make people that way, because hypocrites make more hypocrites. He continues with the third sorrow. He says, blind guides, what sorrow awaits you? For you say that it means nothing to swear by God's temple, but that it is binding to swear by the gold in the temple. He says, blind fools, which is more important, the gold or the temple that makes the gold sacred? And you say that to swear by the altar is not binding, but to swear by the gifts on the altar is binding. There's a lot going on here. This is going to be good for some of you because you were like, oh no, swearing. Yeah, I did that on the way in. That dude was driving super slow and I was running late and he deserved it. I didn't like that I used, like, that's not what we're talking about here. There are probably other verses that we can address. He's not talking about cussing here, so you're fine for now. He's talking about something different. Oaths were very important in that day and age, taking an oath on something. And he's pointing out the hypocrisy again of the religious elites. Why? Because they would make it so that if you swore on money or gold or material things, they would hold you to that oath. But if you swore on the temple, God's dwelling place, they wouldn't hold you to it. Their priorities were all jacked up. They cared so much about status and fame and money and power. They forgot that that value comes from God, not from material things. They had, this third sorrow, they had confused priorities. Religious people, always, we love to confuse priorities. Because if we walk around pretending like we're measuring up, we've already revealed the fact that we don't trust God. We trust in our own efforts and our own selves. Religious people love to confuse priorities. We tend toward it. That's the third sorrow. The fourth sorrow, what sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees? And he says it again, hypocrites! For you are careful to tithe or give 10% of even the tiniest income from your herb gardens, but you ignore the more important aspects of the law, justice, mercy, and faith. Now, some of you are seeing this, and for the first time, you're like, what? I can tithe herbs instead of money? This is great. It is what Jesus said, and so sorry, counting team, you're probably going to get a lot of cilantro this weekend, or herbs, or mint, or dill. No, back then, herbs and spices were super valuable. And so the Pharisees, these religious leaders, would take a lot of effort to make sure that they were giving 10%. So imagine yourself walking in a Kroger and you pick up a thing of cilantro and you wait, like, I got to give 10% here. They were very particular about it. Why? Because it was easy for them to do that. It was easy for them to do that. What was hard for them to do, though? To call out for justice, to show mercy and faith toward other people. That was hard for them. Here's what Jesus says about it. He says, you should tithe, yes, but do not neglect the more important things. Blind guides, you strain your water so you won't accidentally swallow a gnat, but you swallow a camel. What the heck is he talking about here? Both of those animals would have been unclean for Jewish people. Couldn't touch them, couldn't eat them. Right? And so you just imagine, he's using a crazy, ridiculous word picture here. You just imagine you're about to drink a glass of water, and there's a little gnat at the bottom. Now, if you're real thirsty, you might not care. You might just drink that or just hope to avoid it. Some of you are nodding your heads. Others of you think I'm gross. That's fine. You might try to avoid it, but what he's saying here is like you spend so much time trying to get that little gnat out and you forget because this thing is easy for you to do. You get that gnat out and then you take a glass of water. And I don't know how this works. It's impossible probably. But there's a camel. It's a big animal. I've never seen one in person. Big animal in the glass and you look ridiculous. You spent time getting that little thing out of there, but then you're willing to drink a glass of water with a camel in it. And we all look stupid when that happens. And Jesus is pointing something out here, that religion makes you look ridiculous. Religion makes you look ridiculous. Why? Because this fourth sorrow tells us that we like to make it easy on ourselves, but harder on other people. We like to make it easier on ourselves, but harder on other people. What I struggle with, it's fine that I struggle with this thing. Like, I know that like there's this thing I deal with, but Jesus, he loves me. He's forgiven me. But what they do, he doesn't forgive. There's no love or mercy for them. There's justice for them. Like, we love to make it easier on ourselves to say, yeah, I can do that. I read my Bible. Well, you like to read, so that's pretty easy to do. I pray. Well, you can focus, so that's easy for you to do. But that person over there, man, they do not go to church. I know that about them. They struggle with this. I know that about them. We make it easy on ourselves, but we make it harder on others. And we're okay with it because we are hypocrites. Now, the next two sorrows Jesus combined, or I'm going to combine because they're similar and Jesus is making the same point. He says this, "What sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are so careful to clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but inside you are filthy, full of greed and self-indulgence." He says, "You blind Pharisee, first wash the inside of the cup and the dish, and then the outside will become clean too." This is the second one he's going to talk about. He continues and he says this, "What sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, beautiful on the outside, but filled on the inside with dead people's bones and all sorts of impurity." And then he says this, "Outwardly you look like righteous people, but inwardly your hearts are filled with hypocrisy and lawlessness." Religious people, we love to walk around, "Look at how spiritually tall I am. I've got it figured out. I hope that everybody thinks I've got it figured out, because if they think I've got it figured out, we're good. I'm good. Look at how spiritually mature I am. Look at what I do." But inside we know deep down that when we're alone, when people are gone, when we're talking about other people, whatever it is for you, whatever struggle you're carrying, that the inside is dirty. And Jesus invites us to consider the inside and to stop putting up appearances, to stop pretending, to stop acting, to stop being a hypocrite. Because the inside is the part that's the most, like, this is the part that matters, and this is the part that eventually will come out and you will be found out. Sorrows 5 and 6 are faking it. And this is super easy for us to do as religious people because we're all about performance. We love for everybody else to think that we're good. Like, we got, look at my family, look at this, I give, whatever. And love it when people give us accolades for that. Like, look at how good that guy, I wish I was more like, and it feels good. It's a show, we're acting. And if we're honest, and honesty is really the key to following Jesus, if we're honest, we know that it's all a show and that we're acting. And it's an unbearable burden that you were never meant to carry. You weren't the last sorrow. He says this, "What sorrow awaits you, teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites, for you build tombs for the prophets your ancestors killed, and you decorate the monuments of the godly people your ancestors destroyed." He's pointing out to them, like, hey, you got these monuments for the people of the Old Testament, these heroes of the faith, and you love them, and then you talk about those things, and you're like, you know, you're like, we wouldn't have done what the other people did. In fact, he says it. He says next, he goes, "Then you say, if we had lived in the days of our ancestors, we would never have joined them in killing the prophets." So a lot of the Old Testament prophets were murdered by the actual Israeli people, the Jews in the Old Testament. A lot of the heroes of the faith were murdered at the hands of their own people. And they're like, we love that guy, like Isaiah, Jeremiah, those are my dudes, awesome. Now, I know, we wouldn't have done that though. We're better than those people were. This is what religious people love to do. We love to criticize other people. We love to say, like, yeah, I mean, like, that's what they did, but I would have never done that. I'm not going to do it. I don't behave that way. It's a comparison game. We love to point out how good we are and how not good other people are. It's a comparison game. And here's what Jesus does next. He says, but in saying that, in comparing ourselves, and now he's talking specifically to the religious leaders of his day. He does something very interesting here. He says, in saying that, you testify against yourselves that you are indeed the descendants of those who murdered the prophets. And he says, go ahead and finish what your ancestors started. What does he mean by that? Go ahead and finish what your ancestors started. Remember, he's saying, like, you said, I love those prophets. We would have never done what those people did and killed the prophets. And he's like, hey, guess what? In just a little bit of time, you're not just going to kill a prophet. You're going to kill the Son of God. Like, you're going to stand in front of the Roman authorities, and I'm going to be up there being accused, an innocent man, the Son of God. And there's going to be a guy next to me who is an insurrectionist, who's guilty for sure. And you're going to say, free the guilty party and kill the innocent. You're going to do at a way worse scale than what the people before you did. You have no idea how hypocritical you are. And for us religious people, so often we don't even see our hypocrisy when we point fingers out to everybody else and we don't consider where we've fallen short or what we would do given the opportunity. So he says, you're going to do what they did. You are their descendants. And he says, and again, he's very harsh with the religious people. He says, snakes, sons of vipers, how will you escape the judgment of hell? Jesus is very harsh with religious people. And what I know about people who aren't religious, so if you're here and you're not, you're like, I'm not a Christian, I don't believe that stuff. Like, you're probably sitting here today, like, yeah, get them. Get them. But for us religious people, we're like, man, this is tough. This is not what I expected coming to church today. Especially from Andy. He usually makes me laugh the whole time. Make me feel guilty. It's not me. Jesus is the one doing it. I'm just telling you what he said. But what's he warning us about here? Sorrow 7. It's comparing your performance to others. We do this. Look at how spiritually tall I am. I've got it figured out. They don't. They don't. Look what they do. Look what they believe. Look what they do. Look what they say. Look how they treat others. Oh, she's such a gossip, which is such an ironic thing to say out loud. It's gossiping about a gossip, you know? This is dangerous. This is very dangerous. Comparing your performance to others is just as ridiculous as drinking a camel out of water, which sounds impossible, but it's just dumb. And that's what we do all the time. We're tempted toward it. Why is this dangerous? And why should you avoid it at all costs? Because you're going to be found out. You will. It'll come out. Jesus tells us that. We see that throughout the scriptures, that nothing that's in the dark will not, it'll be brought to light. It always will. And remember when Jesus started talking to the people and to us by, like he started by saying, the people who humble themselves will be exalted and those who exalt themselves will be humbled. Those who parade around their spiritual maturity will be humbled. It's a choice of when. The choice is really ours to decide when we want to experience humility. The key to following Jesus is humility and honesty. So the question we all need to ask then is, how can I humble myself? How can I humble myself? And for those of you that have been found out for doing something dumb or stupid like myself, like when you've been caught in a pattern of behavior, that is painful and it hurts. And it ends up being good for you, but it's so much better to just be honest from the get-go. This is the key to following Jesus, is being humble enough to admit that you don't have it all figured out. So how can you humble yourself? How can you be honest about what you've got over here that you don't want people to know about? How can you be honest about the dirty, the filth inside of you that you don't like people to know about, you hope that nobody ever finds? How can you be honest about that and in that experience freedom and in that lose your religion? Because you can lose your religion by being honest about you. You can. And for my fellow hypocrites, which is a lot of you, for my fellow hypocrites, this can feel very difficult and tough, and that's kind of part of the design. But I want you to remember, what Jesus would say to those of us that struggle with this, those of us that are hypocritical, those of us that are tending toward religion on a regular basis. What would he say to us? A few chapters before this in Matthew chapter 11, he says this. He says, come to me, all of you, not just those of you that are in this category or this, but he says, all of you, including the religious people, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart. And you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light. Now, what he is not saying here is that following Jesus is easy and that it just makes your life better. It's not what he's saying here. What he's saying is there's a much better way to the religious way. The burden that religion wants to place on you is to always feel like you have to measure up to be good enough. And we can't. You can't. For those of you that have tried to measure up, you know how silly it is to try that. Because you just can't. But there's a better way. And the invitation to Jesus is just to come to me. He's like, come to me. Trust in me. Trust that I can be the one that regenerates and renews you from the inside out. Not that you're going to, through behavior modification, become good enough so that I love you one day. No, it's trust in me. Trust that I have a good plan. Bring your real self to me, and in that, lose your religion, because you can lose your religion by being honest about you. But this is scary. It's awkward. It's uncomfortable to be honest about you, because it's so much better, we think, to just pretend like everything's okay. It's so much better for people to think, yeah, he's got his life together. She's great. I would like to be more like her. When in reality, we all know Like, we know what we're ashamed of, what we carry all the time, the things that we don't want to talk about, because church sometimes, though we want it to be the safest place ever, it's filled with a bunch of religious people that love to point fingers. It's scary. But here's the awesome thing about Jesus. When you come to him with your mess, when you're like, yeah, you know, you come to Jesus and you're like, hey, I just want to be honest about me. Like, this is something I struggle with. Like, he's not surprised by this. He doesn't hear it and go, what? Are you serious? Well, I really wish I wouldn't have died for you. No, like, that's not the heart of Jesus. When you come to him with your struggles, when you're honest about who you are and what you've got going on that you don't want to have going on, when you're like, yeah, I tend to be really hypocritical. I tend to lie to get out of things. I tend to judge people harshly. I tend to talk about everybody behind their backs and nobody to their face. I have this thing that I look at all the time that I know that I shouldn't be looking at, and I don't want to, and I don't know what to do with it. When you're honest with Jesus, he's like, wow, this is you trusting me. This is the better way that Jesus invites us into. And so today, my invitation, really, in my opinion, it's Jesus' invitation. It's for us to respond to that. It's for us to be like, yeah, okay, I want to lose this religion, this boring, dead, gross, terrible thing that we try to do all the time. And I want to be more real and honest about me. And I want to have a deeper, intimate relationship with Jesus and not this faked stuff. If you want that today, then we have to act. We have to do something. And so I'm going to invite you, no matter where you are today, no matter where you're watching, to stand up wherever you are. Stand up out of your seats, off your couch, whatever. If you've been sleeping, this part's a bummer for you. The people of God were never meant, you and I were never meant to just hear things. And yeah, that was a good message. It felt good. Or man, you made me think about a lot. No, it's not just about thinking. Thinking's good, but it's about doing. And so the invitation today is for you to respond, to start practicing honesty. And so at all of our campuses, and online you'll figure out how to do this, at all of our campuses we have areas that we call response areas. We give you the opportunity to respond to God. And so we're going to play a song, and I'm going to invite you to move around the auditorium wherever you're watching, to move around. There's several different places. If today you were reminded that Jesus measured up for you so that you wouldn't have to measure up, and you want to remember that, and you want to take communion to celebrate and to remember his gift of his life for you, I want to invite you to go to our communion station to take communion and say, thank you, Jesus, for measuring up for me. Maybe today you heard this message and you're like, yeah, I know I got stuff. I got mess. I'm not really aware of all the things, and you want God to make you more aware. You can go to the candle station. In fact, throughout church history, candles have really symbolized illumination. And so you can go to the candle station, light a candle, say, God, really, can you make me aware? Can you illuminate in my soul what I've got going on, this dead, cold religion? Can you help me to see that? You go to the candle station, you do that. Maybe today you want to be real honest and you want to say, I know I've hurt people with my religious demands. I know I've hurt people with the way I've lived, my hypocrisy. Or maybe today you're here and you know you've been hurt by religious people. You've had people place unbearable demands on your life. If you're in one of those two camps, I would invite you to go get some prayer, to have somebody pray for you, to submit a prayer request, and that people pray for you to be forgiven, but also so that you could forgive those that have hurt you. Maybe today, when I was talking about the Pharisees who loved money and loved the material things, you kind of resonated with that, and today you maybe need to give up some of your dependence on material things. Well, I want to invite you to go to the giving station and to give generously back to God and to say, I don't need to depend on this stuff anymore. I want to depend on you. And last but not least, and this is the hardest one, this is the one that's going to take a lot of like courage and a lot of inspiration from the Holy Spirit for you to be able to do this. This is the part where you confess, where you actually say, this is what I'm going through. This is the thing I don't want to have anymore. I don't want to carry this anymore. I don't want to try and measure up. I know this has helped. This is hurting me over here. I want to confess this sin pattern, this thing that's holding me back from an intimate relationship with Jesus. I want to be honest. And God loves it when you're honest with him. But this is super awkward. It's uncomfortable. It can be weird. But we have a station where there's a cross where you can write down, like literally write out what you're going through and pin it to the cross as if to say, hey, listen, I know I'm not going to measure up. And I know that honesty is the key to following Jesus, and I want to follow him with everything, and so today I'm going to respond. Those are your opportunities. Those are the invitations from me, from us, for you to respond to God today. And when we do that, we begin the process of losing our religion. You can lose your religion, by being honest about you.
As a Christian who grew up in the 90s, that was one of my favorite songs, and that is also my prayer for you, is that we would be able to strip away, that we would be able to leave everything that takes us away from the heart of our worship, which is Jesus and Jesus alone. Well, before you go, if you want to experience God more throughout the week, you can text the word MORE to 419-419-0707, and we'll send you a couple of texts during the week to help prompt you in ways that you can grow closer to God. And then also, you may not have realized, but there are four big lies that religion tells us. Number one, I'm not going to tell you. No, you got to come back next week to find out what those lies are and the truths that we can use to combat them. So make sure you tune in next weekend. And again, thank you for joining me this weekend, and I can't wait to see you next week.